Hey everybody, Brian here. I just got finished installing a winch plate from an adventure driven design with an X-Bull winch, and I've been recording some of the process. Figured I would put a video together and share it with everybody. I've had a few people asking what the installation process is like, and honestly I didn't know because I've never done it. I just got finished doing it, documented at least how I did it so everybody could see what the process was, and so I'll get that together for you here. A few things of note. This is my Montero, 1999 Mitsubishi Montero, full size, commonly referred to as the Gen 2.5. I of course got my other parts rig there. I'm robbing some parts off of for differentials and everything. But yeah, so this is mine. It's got coil springs in the back, crank torsion bars in the front. I also have an 1¾ inch body lift. So that was actually, you'll see in the video, that was an advantage for me to have a lot of extra room to work with in the front end. So I'll get putting that together here and you can see what I did. A few things to note. I live about 45 minutes from the nearest town. Don't have a lot of parts houses readily available or salvage yards. Definitely no Mitsubishi dealership around here. So a lot of what I do, I've got to order parts in and kind of work with what I've got. I at least have a decent welder, a decent set of tools, so I can get most everything done that I need to. But you'll see the video's done in stages, mostly because it's my daily driver and I need to put it back together to get to work the next day and work on some more on a weekend or whatnot. So there are some things and modifications I had to make just because of where I am and lack of parts availability, but I think I did a pretty good job with it, and we'll get to going here. Into this. First of all, just looking at everything we need to do this and what I'm doing. So this is the winch plate from Adventure Driven Design. Now this mounts up in between the frame rails. Can't really see it here with the skid plate on. We'll be taking all this off, but it's gonna go right in here, kind of below the bumper between the frame rails. There's a pretty good void up there where this will fit pretty good. And these are the basics. This is the winch I'm putting on. It's the X-Bull winch. Yes, made in China, and a lot of debate on winches, what is the best to have, what not. I've done a little bit of research. I know actually some towing and recovery companies that are running this winch setup and having pretty good success. Yes, I could pay double or triple and go with a different brand, but I am not using this full time. It's kind of a cheap insurance option. Of course, people would say, why get the cheapest insurance when you need it if it's not working, but we're gonna give it a shot. I'm using the 13,000 pound unit. Yes, that's a lot more than the vehicle weighs, but winch ratings are based on the first wrap on the drum. And when you have two or three wraps, the line pull rating actually goes down significantly. Seeing as how most of the winch pulls I would be doing are from a shorter distance and not completely out at 85 feet, I wanted something with a little higher capacity. Also, when you consider a winch that might be pulling you through deep mud or over an obstacle or something, you're actually increasing the amount of load that's going to be on it. So those are some factors to consider when you're looking at a winch, and the size that you want is not just what the weight of your vehicle is, but other circumstances where that line rating may not be enough. So we've got the winch plate and the winch, and then of course I've got all the tools we're going to need to take the bumper off and get things prepped, ready to put this in. To clarify further what I was talking about regarding the winch rating, you can see the line pull for the first wrap of the drum, layer one, shows 13,000 pounds, which is the winch rating. And then shows the second layer at just over 10,000 pounds. And then when you're out to the third layer, you're at 8,800 pounds. So not quite half of the winch rating, but significantly less. That's why I went with a higher rated winch, just to accommodate any
external circumstances, which may be more than the weight of the vehicle, or there's always a chance I could be pulling another heavy vehicle out of the mud or something like that that is more than my vehicle weighs and may need that extra capacity. So that clarifies a little further what I was talking about regarding the layers on the drum and how it decreases the winch rating. Another thing to consider when getting your winch plate and winch set up is you're gonna wanna make sure whatever brand you go with that the winch actually lines up with the mounting holes. Most winches should have a standardized bolt pattern, but it's a good idea to just check, make sure you don't need to do any drilling on your winch plate or modification beforehand, because it's gonna be a lot easier to do with it out rather than after it's welded in. In this case, I have checked it, all the bolt holes mount up properly. The other thing you're gonna wanna do is get some measurements first. You don't wanna get it all in there and realize nothing fits and then have to make modifications after the fact if you can do it all beforehand. It's obviously easier. So just checking my height mainly. I'm right at 7 inches on the body, but you've gotta consider your clutch to disengage things to make sure you got clearance for that. And in this case, we're gonna be right at 9 inches or so. And so I'm gonna wanna take a look at all that when I get the skid plate off and measure everything up, just see what kind of clearances I have in there. I may have to move some of the transmission cooler or some other components in there once we get to setting that up in there. Once you've measured everything up on the winch plate, first thing you're gonna wanna do is get your skid plate off so you can get the underside of the frame rails. You're also gonna need to take off the front bumper. Mine's a little different setup with the bumper risers, the brackets I have to raise the bumper up, but we're gonna get all that taken off and expose the whole front end and get ready to put this winch plate in. First thing first, gotta get some air going. All right, we've got the skid plate off, the bumper off. As you can tell, I actually didn't take the bumper all the way off. I didn't disconnect all the headlight washer lines or electronics for the fog lights. I actually have a louvered hood, so I was able to just kind of hang it off some bungees. The main reason I'm doing that is, as I'm checking fitment for everything, I may want to drop that bumper down, kind of place it over things to look at, you know, how things are matching up, what kind of clearance I have. But it's not required to do that. I just have that luxury because I've got a place to hook things up there. So as we get everything off the front here, you can see the space we got between the frame rails is actually fairly generous. Mitsubishi did a good job. I think, I can't confirm this, but I think they actually intended this to be an area for factory mounted winches, or you know, some other countries may have had it as an option. You've got these frame horns here, and if you look, I don't know if you can see well in here, there's a spacer that is actually underneath here, matches up with that hole, and that is actually going to line up with this hole on the end of the winch plate. So as we fit things up here, we're gonna be using those holes, those spacers on either side as kind of our mark to match things up. And you can see these little dust shields that go around the sway bar. Those will have to get out of here. But it's gonna look something like this. It's all up in there. It's gonna sit up underneath frame rails, and we'll get those dust shields out of the way and get those holes lined up, prep the frame, and we'll get to welding here soon. got the dust shields off and went ahead and put the plate on a jack so I can get it up there and see how everything's gonna fit. Okay, get out the shadows here. As you can see, really good fit here. I know there may be some anomalies with different frames or vehicle damage or different things like that, but for the most part, my vehicle, as far as I can tell, has never been in a wreck. So should be no frame issues. All the cuts, bends, everything are tight and flush against the frame rails. Same thing at the front here. Now the other thing you can do is to check fitment, get a tapered alignment punch like this, and those holes that are underneath. I don't know if I'll get the camera to focus here or not. You can put that alignment punch in those holes underneath your frame rail through the bottom of the skid plate, and that'll help you get everything kind of lined up so you know it's fitting right. And now we're gonna measure some clearances here. If you remember some of my measurements earlier, we had 7 inches from the base of the plate up to the top of the winch body, and then I believe it was 9 inches to the top of the handle to engage and disengage the winch. So what I'm looking at in here, just to make sure we got our 7-inch mark and definitely plenty of clearance to anything up there. On this side where that winch handle will be, I'm gonna set 9 inches just at the top of that radius there. And I hope you can see the cooler in there. Things could be a little close. So just to be sure, I'm gonna go ahead and drop this down, put the winch on there, and we're gonna put it up again just to see how things look for clearance. Okay, you can see I've got the winch on the plate and put it up here again. And also, besides aligning the holes underneath with the alignment punch, I'm also taking it up and taking, I don't know, about a half inch of weight off of the chassis, just so I can be sure the plate is up tight against the frame rails and I'm not giving myself any false clearance measurements. But this side, obviously there's plenty of room, which I like, especially with electronics. I don't like them sitting really close or near anything that can arc or anything like that. Now the lever to engage and disengage the winch is plenty clear from the cooler. I'll have to reroute this auxiliary transmission cooler line to a different spot. It's actually not a problem right now, but a little closer than I like, so I will be rerouting that. But there's plenty of room to engage and disengage this. The trick is going to be, once the bumper and everything's mounted, figuring out the best way to access that. Otherwise, everything looks like it's going to clear pretty well. And again, this vehicle has 1¾ inch body lift, so that's giving me a lot more clearance. If you don't have a body lift, you'll probably have to relocate some of your coolers and cooling lines and radiator components possibly. All right, now that we've got the measurements and know our clearances are good, we need to get prepped to weld. Now, anybody who's planning on doing a welding project on their own, hopefully some of this stuff I'm saying is a given. But if not, just a few things when you're welding. You want to make sure, first of all the surfaces that you're welding are clean. They can't have any paint, corrosives, rust, you know, corrosion, things like that. They should be clean of any contaminants or anything that may destroy the integrity of the weld. So in this case, the plate is obviously brand new material. I am gonna wipe it down to make sure there's no greases or oils on it. And then on the frame rails, obviously, we wanna get rid of any paint or undercoating or anything like that, just the mating surfaces. Now, for me, I'm going to be using a grinder. I did have a flat wheel for this grinder that I tore up on another project. So I'm just using a regular grinding wheel. One note with that, you don't wanna take away too much material. You just wanna get it clean, but you don't wanna take away too much of the materials that you're welding, because that's part of the integrity. So I'm just gonna get it as clean as possible with a regular grinding wheel, and then I'm probably going to clean it up a little bit more with a wire wheel, and then we'll get to welding. One other note before I start grinding or cleaning any metal, I made some marks. I just used a regular soapstone pen here. Made some marks. I put the plate up again just so I know where I need to clean material on both sides and underneath. Just don't want to take any more material, original paint or undercoating away than necessary. Now I typically try to clean off about a quarter inch to a half inch on either side of any area I'm going to weld. Gives me plenty of room for the bead, and then also keeps paint from baking and contaminating the weld. All right, I ground off the areas where I'm gonna be welding to, give myself plenty of clean metal to weld to. Now you can see some of these areas where factory welds are. There's still a little bit of pitting and, you know, just areas in the original weld where I can't get that grinder. So that's why I'm gonna use the wire wheel to clean everything as much as possible before I start welding. Okay, I finished with the wire wheel on the grinder, and you can see some of these areas at the factory welds that were still had a little bit of corrosion, you know, rust in them. I got a lot cleaner, a lot better area for weld to be able to be a clean weld. And then also after I was done, I went ahead and just took a regular wire brush and scrubbed everywhere around the areas that I'm going to be welding, just getting dust and dirt and all sorts of other debris off of all the mating surfaces. And then also underneath the frame rails as well. I wanted them as clean as possible. When I get the winch plate up, I could feel a little bit of kind of sand and gravelly material under there. So I just wanted that as clean as possible, so it's as tight up against the frame rails as possible without any chance for debris to be in there, and which could eventually lead to corrosion and rust, an area for water to get trapped in the future. So trying to make sure everything's as clean as possible so the welds are strong and there's less chance of corrosion down the road. Okay, now before I get the winch plate up there ready to weld everything, I also want to clean this. A lot of times in the manufacturing process, different machines may use different types of oils for making the breaks in the metal, drills, different things. They're gonna have some type of oil on the metal that helps with the manufacturing process or the fabrication process. So you wanna make sure all the oils and any residues clean off of there. There's a variety of products you can use, all of which I'm out of. So I'm gonna use a trusty old starting fluid to absorb any of the oil and evaporate that off and wipe it down really good. See just that amount of oily residue on this, even though it looks like bare metal. That's what I'm getting off of there, again, to make everything as clean as possible. All right, I've got this winch plate jacked up into place, and what I did this time is I got it up close. I took a little bit of weight off the suspension. I used my alignment punch to line up those holes underneath. I jacked it up a little bit more, checked it again with that alignment punch. I did that two or three times, and I took 2 or 3 inches of weight off the suspension, so I know the plate is nice and tight under the frame rail, you know, as minimal gaps anywhere as possible. And I kept rechecking the alignment with that alignment punch to make sure it's all in place. You can see my all the clearances and everything at the front match. Everything looks very consistent and even all the way across. All my welds everywhere where I need to weld, everything's clean and ready to go in here. So now we're gonna get the welder set up. I'm using a little Hobart MIG welder. It's about as much as this wants to do. This is rated for up to 1/4 inch metal, which is what we're working with. Anybody familiar with welding knows how to read these, but you know, we're looking at the 1/4 inch chart here. I'm using flux cord wire, and so I'm looking at 5 on my voltage and 40 on my wire feed speed, which with this welder, it's a pretty consistent welder, and other stuff I've worked on, it's always been really dead on. I don't have to make many adjustments for what it calls for. I'm making sure I've got plenty of wire on my spool and everything's all ready to go. Okay, we're gonna get to welding here. Anybody who knows what they're doing with welding, this is not new information, but if this is your first time taking on a project like this, a few welding tips. You want to make sure you make some tack welds just to hold everything in place, get all your corners in place, solid. That way, first of all, you can take your jack or whatever out of the way to give you more room to do everything you need to. When you're welding, you don't want to work on all one side and then go to the other side. You may run a bead on one side and move to the other side, do a bead, kind of go back and forth so you're not generating a lot of heat in one specific area. With welding or anytime you heat metal, it's going to pull one direction or the other. So you want to make sure you're kind of alternating back and forth so that your everything's staying square and in place where it should be. You're not pulling, warping, or twisting anything. So with that, I'm going to hit all the corners here just to hold things in place with tack welds. I may do a stitch on either end, and then I'll move the jack out of the way and we'll get to welding on the rest of the stuff. Right, so you can see I just made welds at all the corners, everywhere where there's going to be any full beads made. I just made welds to hold everything in place so nothing's going to move. And now I'm going to start running my full long beads along all the mating surfaces. Well, I started having problems while I was welding. Thought it was just some slag in my torch tip. Took that off, cleaned that out. The cone is pretty clean. Couldn't figure out what's going on. I think I did have a little slag in the torch tip that stopped it up, but looks like all my wire got jammed up and started feeding, and now I've got to run all this through the MIG gun again to get it working right. So if you're not familiar with welders that often or have something like that happen, one of the common problems that can cause that, a couple different things. You can get some slag in your torch tip. this, or your stinger tip, this piece goes on here, the wire runs through the end of that, and if you get too much slag on here when you're welding, that can block the wire and cause it to clog up in the wire feed. The other problem that could have happened, you need to keep this whole line as big sweeping loops as possible. Try not to have any coils or kinks, because that can cause your line to get jammed up. And then on occasion, you might get your spool, if that's a little tight and it's not pulling out correctly, that can cause a jam up. In this situation, that's not what happened. It was something from here forward. And so we've got that fixed. I got the line cut back and fed in, and just gonna run it through here. And there's the new wire. Okay, I've got all the welding done, and had a couple issues with the welder in the middle there, mostly because of slag in the stinger tip. But you can also see I had to drop my bumper down so I could get some better access into some of the spots. Honestly, probably would have been easier to just take the bumper off. I do like having it there so I can kind of fit things up easily. But the other thing I realized towards the end was some of the welds are on the back of the winch plate. Would have been a lot easier to get to without my wheels on. So that may be something to consider, is you know, having those removed, you can get around the backside a little better. I was able to do it just fine, but definitely would have been easier without the wheels on, especially with the bigger tires. So anyway, just letting things air out, letting the welder cool down here. It's about 10 o'clock at night, and kids are in bed, and I'm out here working. One thing I'm gonna have to do is clean up. There's a lot of slag. I don't know if you can really see it in there, but a lot of slag on the bottom of the winch plate, which isn't gonna give me a clean mounting surface for the winch. So I'm gonna have to clean that up a bit. But otherwise, got the welds all the way around the back of the winch plate here, on the sides, up in the front. Pretty much got everywhere I possibly could to get some good strength to the whole unit. All right, another thing that might be worth having when you do a project like this, having a good wire wheel attachment for your grinder. Obviously, again, a wire brush. With the amount of slag that was inside the mounting surface on the winch plate, I couldn't even scrape much of it with a chisel or a file. I actually had to get the grinder in there and get some of the heavy slag off close to the welds. But then I was able to use the wire wheel, go across the entire surface of the winch plate, and get things cleaned up pretty good. So I've got a nice smooth surface for the winch to mount on without any debris or anything like that in place. Okay, we're wrapped up with the welding. Put all the welder away, swept my work area. I hit everything with a wire wheel, mainly just to get things cleaned up as best I could, get the mounting area good and clean. I also went over all the areas where I welded just to make sure everything was as clean as possible, and get my all the welded surfaces free of debris, because we're gonna to get some primer on all this and get it ready for paint and get the winch installed. First thing though, I'm gonna actually set the winch up in there, make sure everything still clears the way I want it to, and then we'll get to painting and leave it be for the night. I've got the winch set up in here now, and just like we measured before, everything clears really well. All the electrical terminals have plenty of clearance around them. The handle to engage and disengage again. We're gonna move this transmission cooler line, but there's plenty of clearance to any of the hard mounted parts. And everything looks like it's gonna fit up pretty good here. Last thing I'm gonna do tonight before I call it quits is get some primer and paint on this. Of course, any bare metal, you want to have some kind of protective enamel on it to keep it from rusting. And I'm also going to go ahead and clean the entire the whole compartment below the radiator and everything, just to get some of the old oil residue and things like that off while I'm in here. Have access to it right now. Try to get things cleaned up a little bit more. And I'm gonna paint pretty much the whole front end of the frame area. I'm gonna wire brush everything, wipe it down really well with some thinner, and then get a coat of paint on everything so it looks nice. Okay, so to wrap up the evening, I've put a coat of primer on everything, let it dry for about a half hour or 45 minutes, and came back and did a coat of semi-gloss black, and again, just painted everything to freshen it up a little bit. Again, I wiped down the whole compartment back here below the radiator just to get any debris or residue off that I could. While I was back there, I had a power steering pump leak a few months back, and I went ahead and fixed that, but there was some leftover oil residue back in there. So cleaned everything up, got it all painted. Gonna let all this dry and be ready for getting a winch installed tomorrow. Looks like everything is set up pretty good. It's been about 15 or 20 hours. Paint's not tacky. And it is time to get the winch set in there and bolted down so I can start wiring up the rest. Next, I'm gonna be getting the winch set up in here and bolted down so I can start first measuring up to see where I need to make cuts in the skid plate for the roller fair lead and all that equipment. And then after that, we'll be hooking up all the electronics for the winch. But looking at this winch, some have tapped mounting holes. This one actually has slots here. You have these little square nuts. They're gonna install into that slot. Then the bolt's gonna go through the bottom of the winch plate up into that square nut. And the only thing I don't like about this kit, I don't know if you can see the rating, 8.8 metrics. Roughly 120 pound tensile strength on the bolts, equivalent to like a grade 5 SAE bolt. I'm probably gonna end up taking these out and using 10.9 or 12.9 metric bolts. Those have, I think 10.9 is like 150,000 pound tensile strength. 12.9 is 175 or something like that. Something closer to a grade 8 bolt. Obviously, engineers have decided this is sufficient, but I'm one of those who thinks more strength is never a bad thing. So I'll probably upgrade those eventually, but to get this mounted and installed, I'll use what they've supplied. I will need to take off the zip tie and the plastic packaging there to pull the winch line out the front and get everything mounted properly and get the fair lead set up. Now I've got the winch mounted, got all the bolts in. Part of the difficult part with that was the back captive nuts were a little difficult to access. I did get them without having to take the winch back out, but one thing you can do if the winch you have gives you problems, you can put a little grease on the bottom of the nut or even a piece of tape to just hold it in place there as you set the winch in. That way the nut's in place and then you can run the bolt up through the bottom and not have to deal with trying to fish your fingers back there. And it's pretty tight quarters, especially with this bigger winch. I did put all the bolts in, tightened them down, and then torqued them to spec. My actual clicker torque wrench is out of commission right now, so I'm using the old school torque wrench. But again, I'm going to be replacing all these bolts with the heavier grade hardware anyway, so I'm not too worried about the torque at this point. And now we're going to mount the roller fair lead. One issue I'm seeing right now is the size of the body on this winch. It gives me very little room up here. There's enough room to kind of fit my finger behind here and put the bolts through for the roller fair lead. But if the threads on the end of the bolt project past the end of the nut too far, they're gonna run into that winch. So I may need to space those out a little bit, which isn't a big deal. It's not really a part of the integrity of the winch setup. So if I have to space that out, we can do that. All right, I've got the roller fair lead mounted. Took a little more effort than I planned on. As I was discussing earlier, the front of the winch is really tight against the front of the winch plate. So it really limited the amount of space I had to get the nut in there. In fact, I had to take the nut and just file down a couple thousandths, just to the bevel really, so I could get the nut between the winch plate and the winch. And then the other difficult part was holding the nut in place. There's virtually no room for fingers behind there now. So I ended up taking a piece of baling twine, making a little cradle to suspend the nut between the winch plate and the winch and hold it in place while I got the bolts in. And then the bolts were also a little bit too long. A couple options you have in a situation like that. You can either go find shorter bolts. They were only about a thread too long, so you could also shave the end of the bolt down a little bit or add another spacer. In this case, I just added an additional washer and was able to get everything to fit the way I wanted. Because of the space between the winch and the winch plate, I could not get a lock washer on the nut side. So I put it on the bolt side and also added some blue thread locker to help hold things in place. That is definitely something I'm going to need to be checking and rechecking on occasion to make sure everything's staying tight.
Okay, the next thing I need to check for is clearance on everything so I can get my bumper and skid plate mounted back up. I know for a fact the bumper is going to fit because with the 1¾ body lift and the brackets I have to raise the bumper up to match that, the actual bottom of the bumper sits just at the top of the frame rails, which clear all of this area here. So I'm not going to worry about measuring the bumper now. I know when I drop that down, all that's going to clear. I may have to bend the license plate or manipulate it somehow. So really what I'm worried about now is the skid plate. I'm just using the factory skid plate right now. Eventually I'll get, there's two or three companies that offer skid plates, or I might make my own. But I'm going to take this skid plate and just modify it. When I mount this up to the factory location, it won't come up here because obviously the roller fair lead is in the way, so I'm going to have to cut this part out. And then I may, once I cut this out, I may have to cut some over on the ends here to clear the winch plate. We'll see, it might take a few different cuts to get it all done, but we're going to take care of that right now.
I've got the skid plate modified so it'll fit up around the winch and winch plate setup. First, I just measured with a soapstone and a tape to notch out the middle little air grill part and put it up there. I realized I was going to need a lot more than just that notched out. And so I took the entire thing off, measured a little more, realized I'm going to have to notch out about a 2-inch section of the winch plate. This sat right in there like that. I just used a cutoff wheel, went across this natural seam right there, and then cut down the sides, bent it back and forth to break it off so it's fairly straight. I'm gonna hit all this with the grinder, clean it up so there's no sharp edges, and of course clean and paint this whole thing, and we'll get it mounted up. I've got this stage done for now. The winch is mounted in the winch plate. Roller fair lead is on. Got the bumper remounted and the skid plate on. Had to do a couple things on the bumper just because of the size of the winch motor. Some of my bolts, the through bolts for the riser brackets were a little long, so I had to shave one bolt down a little bit so it didn't contact the winch motor. And then trying to think what else. I just cut these down a little bit just to give a little bit of the factory look on the side there and cover up the ends of the frame. Eventually I'll have aftermarket skid plates on here or make my own, but for now, pretty clean setup, and I'll be working on wiring and all that in the next few days. One other note is one of the things I was considering when I first started this is how I'm going to get to the lever to engage and disengage the winch. But fortunately, with the body lift and the bumper brackets that raise things up, I can actually fit under here pretty well and get to that lever to engage and disengage it. And I don't have to reach down behind the radiator or anything like that. So it's going to work for me for now. I may figure out another system later, but for now it's going to be functional. So we've got the winch mounted, the roller fairlead on, bumper, skid plate back in place. Next thing we need to do is start figuring out how to get power to the unit. Now this X-Bowl winch comes with a solenoid box. It's actually got fairly short electrical connections, so I'm going to have to get those lengthened to mount it anywhere remotely. Initially, my plan was to mount it somewhere here in the engine compartment. As you know, Monteros don't have a lot of generous space when it comes to mounting. But as I started looking around, one thing I might consider doing is mounting it on top of the winch like it's set up. Because of my body lift, there's actually a generous amount of room between the top of the winch and any of the cooling components. So I've got to take some measurements, but I might take modifying the brackets on the bottom of this because it is intended to mount on top of the winch. With a little modification, I might actually be able to mount it on top and not have to worry about any remote mounting options. So I'll do some measuring and we'll get back to you and see what might work. I went ahead and pulled the bolts on the bumper again so I could lift that up to get access in here. And let me adjust my lights. So it looks like I am going to have plenty of access below the cooler. Now this, I'm holding this up here backwards, but this solenoid box does fit on top of the winch and gives me about a, I don't know, 1/4 inch of clearance below the cooler. So it's going to work. The one problem is, and again, this will be oriented 180 degrees from where it is with the cables at the backside, but the one problem is where the plug-in controller mounts is right at the cooler, so the tabs on the handle, when it's plugged in, these tabs are going to hit that cooler. So first I tried to First, I tried to pull that nut loose so I could rotate the connector, and it looks like they've got it epoxied in there. Not just the wire connections, but I think the whole socket is epoxied in there or something, because it won't budge. So what I'm going to do instead is just shave one of these tabs off, whichever one is going to be against that cooler. I'm just going to shave that off so it'll clear. And then the other thing I'm going to do, or I already have done, these are the mounting brackets that are going to go on top of the winch to hold this on. Now, they originally sat like this and centered it directly over that. What I'm going to do, or I have done, is drilled this extra hole, shifted it a little bit, so that gives me another quarter inch that I can slide the entire box forward away from that cooler, and everything should clear, and I shouldn't have to make any modifications or do any mounting inside the engine bay if all this works the way I want it to. So I've got the control box, the solenoid pack mounted on top of the winch. And as we measured before, there's roughly a quarter inch clearance between the top of the box. So it's gonna fit in there just fine. One thing I had to do was to get these brackets and everything on the way I wanted. I actually had to pull this, so I'm gonna show you. That crossbar at the backside there, pulled these Allens off the side and pulled that out so I could slip the box in there and then put that crossbar back in. A little tight, but again, fortunately with the body lift I have, that's made a lot more clearance than I expected to do a lot of this work. So got all the cables hooked up. X-Bull does a nice job color coordinating everything, so I know what cables go where. And the last thing I had to do was, again, because that plug on top is right next to the cooler, even though I moved it forward quite about a quarter inch or so, I still needed some more clearance for these tabs on the side. So on this side, I just cut that off and filed it down a little bit. And now that will actually go up in there. Film and plug things in at the same time. Make sure I'm facing the right way. So that plugs in there and has clearance against the cooler to not rub anything. And again, that's not gonna be in there all the time. That's only when I actually need to use the winch if I choose not to use the wireless controllers. Ideally, if the wireless controllers work, I won't need to plug that in ever, but it's there in case I need it. So that's going to be it for tonight. I'm going to put the bumper back on. I've got to work tomorrow, and I don't know, in the next couple days we'll get power hooked up to this, get it grounded, and make it work. All right, I'm back at it, ready to start getting electrical hooked up. One thing I realized as soon as I started laying everything out is, you know, I have all my electrical connections on top, but there's a ground which grounds to the motor. And that is a stud directly underneath the motor. It's virtually impossible for me to reach with the size of the motor and the space between the winch plate. Virtually impossible for me to reach the stud from outside. And I can either pull the motor out and get the ground cable installed, or I can figure out another way to get to it. So my solution actually, another benefit will be for field work. I'm going to drill a 2-inch hole in the bottom of the winch plate so that I can access that stud, get the ground cable hooked up, and then also if I have issues in the field, need to do any troubleshooting, it'll be a lot easier for me to get under there and, you know, check connections and things like that. This winch plate is beefy enough, and where I'm going to be drilling the hole, I'm not going to be taking away from the overall integrity of the installation. So that's what I'm going to be doing now, is getting the hole drilled in the bottom to access the ground cable, or the stud for the ground cable, and then we'll get the rest hooked up. One note I wanted to make in regards to the hole saw and drilling in this thick of metal, without a drill press or a mag drill, it can be a little bit difficult. I went ahead and bought a brand new hole saw. I had some others, but just not knowing how good they were and if they were going to just be too dull to do the job right, I just bought a new one to do this. It's a 2-inch hole saw. That's big enough for me to get my fingers in there onto the lug and get everything tightened and get tools in there. It specs out, I don't know if you can see this, for mild steel, as high as 195 RPM and down to 150 RPM. But since I'm using a drill, I have no way to know what RPMs I'm working at. It's not a drill press or anything where you can set all that. So pretty much if you haven't used a drill or a hole saw before in this type of application, you just have to go till you feel it cutting really well without going too fast and burning the teeth on the bit or going too slow and binding up or not accomplishing anything. All right, I've got the hole drilled out of the bottom of the winch plate so I can access that ground lug. As you can see, I had a pilot bit in here, but I took it out at the very end before I got all the way through because I wasn't sure if the pilot bit would end up coming in contact with the ground lug on the winch motor. So I took that off before I got all the way through. Have a nice little plug that came out there. And then you can see underneath here, the ground lug that we need to get to hook up the ground cable. Easy to get to, easy to get tools in there. I'm going to go ahead and get some primer on there and touch that up with paint before I do anything else. Okay, so the paint is dry underneath where I drilled the hole for the ground lug. You can see my connection there. And you'll also notice there's another smaller wire that comes from the solenoid pack that needs to be connected to the ground also. And took the ground cable and the power cable. I initially intended to run them up here under this track here behind the radiator and over to the battery, but they didn't quite give me enough to do it that way. So what I ended up doing is routing the cable behind the motor, kind of around the back through here and up behind and up to the battery here. You'll notice I have extra power cable coiled up here. Since I had to route it a different direction, I ended up with excess, which is fine. I connected it to the main lug on the battery terminal. When I know everything works, I'm probably gonna go ahead and cut that back and crimp on a new connection so I don't have that excess cable. Anytime you're running more length than necessary, that just generates heat, a little bit of loss of power. So I'm gonna try to make it as direct as possible and less problems in the future. Run the ground lug over to this side and I hooked it to the main lug as well. I don't like these type of terminals. It was on here when I bought this and was gonna switch it out whenever the battery dies. But for now, I've got that hooked up here, direct power. One thing I do want to do eventually is get a fusible link or something to put on here. There's two, you know, arguments about whether you need a fusible link or anything in there, but you know, starters don't have them or anything like that. But again, starters are only running for, you know, a few seconds at a time until a vehicle starts, but winch motors can be running for, you know, several minutes at a time. So you want something if you generate heat or have issues with power that will break the circuit rather than burning some wiring up or your battery or something like that. So that will happen eventually as well. Okay, now we're gonna get this thing tested out. I've got all the power hooked up, ready to go. And I'm gonna try the wireless remote first, see how this works out. It says need to push both buttons for 5 seconds till the LED light goes on. There we have an LED light. And I'm gonna have my son help me real quick. Jeremiah, can you grab that hook? Okay, I'm gonna push the button and you just keep pulling on it really hard, okay? Here we go. Oh, there we go. Pull really hard. Ready? Mm-hmm. Keep pulling. Okay, keep pulling really hard, and I'm gonna go back the other way, okay? Good job. Okay, we know the motor works both directions. Now I'm gonna make sure the clutch works to disengage things. Remember, I had just enough room to reach up in here and disengage that, so I'm gonna pull that. Working well. Okay, Jeremiah, can you grab that hook again? You pull it really hard. Thing I'm going to check is to make sure the corded controller works. If you remember, I had to do a little modification to the plug so it would plug into the top of the solenoid box and clear all the coolers and everything. So I've got that plugged in now. A nice basic controller here. I'm going to see if this is going to work for me here. Like that all works, and we have a successful installation so far. Last thing I'm going to do before buttoning things up is I'm going to get the winch cable re-spooled. They come from the factory pretty loose, so I just pulled it all the way out, hooked up to a tire, so I've got some weight. I'm going to go ahead and get it spooled up so it's nice and tight around there. And I grew up in the crane and rigging business a little bit, so it's a pet peeve of mine to have cable spools that aren't right. So I'm gonna go ahead and get that wound up here, make sure it's right, and we'll call it a day on this one. All right, got the cable spooled up and pretty looking on the drum there. As I was spooling things up, when I did the first wrap, I used a hammer and kind of a pry bar to pry it over and pack that first wrap tight on the drum, and then all the other ones kind of lay in the groove accordingly after that. And the cable will kind of get a memory over time, but anytime you go out and use a winch, it's not always, you don't always have the luxury to get everything spooled up the way you want it to. So it's always a good idea when you get home, if you've had to use it, to stretch it all the way out and get it coiled up right. Just, it helps preserve your cable and everything. All right, it looks like everything's working, and I'm gonna go ahead and call it good on this video. I appreciate everybody in the Montero community, all the support for a vehicle platform that's highly underrated and but very capable. And let's all keep the brand going and supporting each other in this community. Thanks a bunch.